All right, let's move on. Our first hearing is a special permit for larger signs by Emily Wittenberry, if I mispronounced that, I apologize, for 1 Amber Lane, Northampton, map ID 31D-143. And they, this was published on August 31st and September 7th. So I take it you're Emily?
I am.
All right, if you could give us a rundown on what it is you're requesting, that would be great, thanks.
Yeah, sure. So I have a new business that just opened up at 1 Amber Lane, which is the carriage house across the street in the Sonic Street parking lot. And we opened Iconica Social Club, which is sort of a multifaceted arts and events space with a small cafe. We make our own juices and coffees and pastries on site and hold arts-related community events that are geared toward the student population as well as the local artists. And we have a sign, we just opened 2 months ago, and we have a sign on our building that's the projecting kind that blades out toward Amber Lane instead of the flat kind that would sit flat on the building. And it is outside of the zoning board's regulations of being 6 square feet or less. And so I'm coming before the board today to ask permission to keep the sign that I have already designed and installed that is a larger sign than the normal requirements. And I should explain, which I have like a whole, the submission that I gave to you guys, which is very detailed and goes into a lot of different components. But I just want to underscore the fact that I didn't realize that the sign that I was putting up was outside the regulations, and so that's why it's only just a little bit outside and kind of like strangely slightly outside of the rules. So we weren't intending to do something that was outside the regulations at the time, otherwise we would have come before you before we put the sign up. So it extends 40 inches out from the building. We have a 48 inch public sidewalk that goes down Amber Lane and goes into the front entrance. So it's within the 48 inch sidewalk as a 40 inch blade sign. And it has two parts. It has a main sign that is about 11 square feet that's made out of a few different mixed metals, and it says Iconica Social Club on it. Below that, on a small hanging rider, we have a little sign that's about 2.25 square feet that reads Minim Juicery, which is a small kind of pet project that we're doing inside our cafe for a line of cold pressed juices that we're starting. So it has like a more temporary feel and kind of swings on these hooks below the bigger sign. And the reason that we chose the size and look and even just the specific blade decision is because of where we're located in downtown. So we're not on the main street. It's definitely more of a destination that you stumble upon than it is something that you would just walk by and notice. People have to go down Cracker Barrel Alley, or even if they're inside the Masonic Street parking lot paying for parking, they have to look over and notice that the building's there. So we were choosing something that would draw people's attention not only to our building, because many people just kind of glaze by it because it's been closed for many years, but also draw them to the fact that it is a public-facing business and that the entrance is on the Amber Lane side. So you actually have to go down the lane to get to our front door. And so we felt that the choice that we made was appropriate for the style of business that we're doing. It has a very kind of homey interior. It's very welcoming, very intimate, a more sort of understated kind of business. So we didn't want a big flashy sign on the side of the building. We just kind of wanted this thing that peeked out a little bit and sort of got people interested and pulled them down the lane and to the entrance. And I feel like the sign that we designed and installed sort of hits all of those marks. It's in keeping aesthetically with the historical nature of the building, of the area around our building. I think it's sort of well suited. We reached out to a bunch of our neighbors. I included the letters in my application. A lot of different people showed their support, both business owners, property owners, as well as residential tenants in the area. So it seems that people in the written form have come toward us with a lot of support, as well as, of course, just the community embracing us at large so far with our business, which has been really amazing. We've been open a little bit over 2 months now, and it seems like people are really kind of taking to to what we're doing. So I guess I'm just formally asking for your support in keeping the sign that we have. Thank you.
Questions?
Just information that may be questions for Carolyn.
Mm-hmm.
There's a second sign that we don't need to, a sandwich sign, is that not part of this?
When I, are you looking at the paper application?
Yes.
So originally I thought that you, so I filled out the $60 sign permit form with Lewis Hasbrook, and I thought that you did A-frame signs on that, so that's why it's written on there, but that's a whole separate thing with John Frey, I believe, so that's not part.
Okay, so we're just looking at this one.
The building, there are specific requirements to be met for a sandwich board sign, and I'm not sure if that's been reviewed, but it's through the building department. So the sandwich board signs are not part of the special permit application.
It was on the paper.
Yeah, typically for new for businesses that are off Main Street, you can have one on Main Street directing people down.
And the other is, based on Emily's background that she presented, that she had thought that she was really signing within. Because of reading it as a, using measurements from a flat sign versus a projecting sign. Would she have had to get that permitted? What's the permit process if your sign is within?
It doesn't matter if you want to put a sign up, you always have to file for a sign application at the building department before you install your sign. So for whatever reason, that got, you know, the cart got put before the horse.
Oh, okay. So that would have actually brought this to her attention.
Caught it, exactly.
Yeah.
Okay.
And the sign's illuminated.
Yep, it has a like a bullet light that is next to it that kind of shines down toward it.
And you turn that off when you close?
Mm-hmm. It's on a timer.
Questions?
Is there anybody else that wants to speak for this application?
I just want to say as a community
member. Why don't you come up and let us know your name and.
Oh, Gloria Santiana. I've lived in Northampton for 17 years now, maybe close to 20. And I just want to support the Iconoclast application. It's such a very welcoming space for community members to come. It's only $10 to rent at night, and I find as somebody who knows a lot of community people who want to rent and meet and collaborate with people, that's very, very accessible. And it's a wonderful space, that a sense of community, given the fact that everything's affordable there, which, you know, for people on fixed incomes in Northampton is really, really nice thing to have. So I just want to, as a community member, say it's a really wonderful place.
Great, thank you. Anybody else? Or is there anybody else that wants to speak against this? Are there any other questions? Or is there a motion to close the public hearing?
I'll move to close the public hearing.
I'm sorry.
All those in favor? Anyone want to make a motion?
You make a motion and then
it looks fine.
Yeah.
Do you want to make it?
Yeah, I move that we vote on approving the sign as described as currently exists.
And I second that.
Any discussion?
I think it's somebody who clearly would have followed protocol had she understood it and been aware of it. And signs are very well placed in a way that seems safe.
Seems
not out of scale with the building.
Any staff concerns? Okay. Ready to vote? All those in favor? All right. Congratulations.
Thank you. Also was published on August 31st and September 7th. Who is
here in support of this application. Could you state your name and then give us a...
Absolutely. And I'll be very brief because I'm counsel. So my name is Rich Seifek, and I'm an attorney from Springfield with the law firm of Ross & Ross. And I represent the petitioner. It's called American Dream Realty, LLC. I'm the director of the project that you're about to hear about. It's on 55 Dane Road. With me tonight are my clients, Mr. Manny Sardina, and Rob Levesque from R. Levesque Associates, who's been designing this whole project. Just by way of background, just so you understand a little bit about Mr. Sardina. Mr. Sardina and his family are from the Westfield area. They currently own, and I'll probably get the number wrong every time I pick a number, it's one or two off. I think he's at 15 now?
14.
14, see? I'm always one off. But they currently own 14 Dunkin' Donuts, family operated and owned. They have an excellent reputation in every city and town that they've done business in. Whatever representations that they make tonight, relative to this site, improving the site, I can guarantee you that their word is their honor. I've been involved with Mr. Sardina on a number of projects, and if you drive around Western Massachusetts and look at any one of them, they're first-class operations. And I can say that with truth. Also with me is Rob Levesque, who I think you know. Rob also has a very excellent reputation in the community, in this city and in every city that he's worked in. We've worked on a number of projects together, and we've been working diligently with this project. By way of background, Mr. Sardina became aware of this Dane Road site back in February, probably January of this year. And immediately Rob and I contacted Carolyn, and we've been working over the past 6 months trying to develop and design the site to make it work. In June 20th, we had a department head meeting with all the department heads here in Northampton and discussed a number of issues, of which are always very productive. We went back to the drawing board, and Rob will explain the changes that have occurred since June. As you know, we're seeking a finding. Under Chapter 48, Section 6, this is a pre-existing non-conforming use. By way of background, this has been an auto dealership. But it goes all the way back to 1958. It was formerly owned by the Bach Company. It was an auto wheel balancing company that was there. Then it was the Bach Tire Company. And in 1985, the Ford dealership was there. And for the past 32 years now, it's been a car dealership. And I know it's had some troublesome issues in the town or the city of Northampton. Relative to the size of the parcel is 1.85 acres, and there's been a number of issues that I think we're going to address all of them. The game plan, and I'm not going to take away from Rob because he'll explain the whole thing, but there's an existing big, large building. The game plan is to basically take down a good portion of that building and to build a freestanding drive-through Dunkin' Donuts. And then the remaining part of the building is going to be retrofitted for some sort of commercial use. There have been discussions with potential tenants, but nothing has been put in writing yet. With that being said, I'll just turn it over to Rob, and I'll be available to answer any questions. Thank you.
Good evening. Again, for the record, Rob Levesque from R. Levesque Associates. If it pleases the board, what I'll do is I'll kind of go through the site plan. I don't know if I can take this microphone away from the podium or not. Does that work?
Yeah, you're actually
probably
not
a good
used.
Idea. Oh, it's not?
No.
Oh, okay. So I can
for
go
planning
anywhere.
Board,
can go anywhere.
Right. Planning okay. Board will be used, but the microphone's on that.
Okay. All right. So if it's okay, and anyone in the audience that wants to see this, if you could, I'm trying to make sure everyone can see it.
This is an update. Oh, it is open.
So is everyone familiar with the site on the board?
No.
Okay. So the former car sales building is a little bit hard to see on my plan, but what it is, it's basically this.
You know what would be great?
Sure.
Why don't you move this all forward?
Absolutely. I can come right there.
Right
or
here.
Right.
No, just in the center.
Oh,
right. Right. Yeah, right here would be great. I plead age-related. So.
I don't know. Are those folks allowed to come up closer so they can see too?
Sure. I mean, it's on the screen as well.
Okay. So this is Industrial Drive here.
Yes.
Damon
yes.
Road here.
Yeah. I think we have this, right?
I can't see where he's pointing. It's on the screen, but where is Industrial Drive?
So,
well,
I'm in the bugger.
Yeah,
it's
to see what he's
okay. So,
do you want to come stand up here so you could see?
So I could see.
I could,
see
yeah, okay. Thank you. Appreciate that.
Thanks.
Sorry about that. So Industrial Drive is here. Okay, this is Damon Road. This is Route 91, and this is continuing into the industrial park down here. Okay. The existing structure that is there is a former auto sales and repair building. What the plan is to basically retain a portion of that building. A little over 6,000 square feet of that building would be retained. Okay? The rest of the building to the east is going to be demolished. In place of that building, that portion of the building, we would be constructing the proposed Dunkin' Donuts. Would be about 2,500 square feet, typical to the standard Dunkin' Donuts, newer Dunkin' Donuts that you see. What we're proposing is parking associated with this building here, in the front and back, with some overflow parking here. We have our two curb cuts, one off Industrial Drive and one off Damon Road. And the idea is that the traffic, we understand that, you know, the Dunkin' Donuts is always a question about stacking, et cetera. So what we've done is we've designed the Dunkin' Donuts in a way, and the rest of the site in a way that we can accommodate a significant amount of stacking spaces from the from the pickup window. But this, right, what you see here is this is the ordering kiosk, which is typically about 5 stacking spaces back, and then this is the pickup window. So the idea would be that in the event that there's a significant amount of stacking, we can accommodate that within the site. On all these Dunkin' Donuts, we always try to have a bypass lane, and so there's really 2 lanes here. It's not because we want more impervious surface, but it's really specific to the drive-through use. So that in the event that somebody wants to escape that lane, they don't want to wait in line for whatever they might be ordering, they can get out and get around. We've also provided with that lane a loading area so that the deliveries to Dunkin' Donuts can get near the building and they can unload safely in that location. So there's two curb cuts, one on Damon Road and one on Industrial Drive. We work closely with your planner on both of those curb cuts and trying to eliminate those. There are some improvements that are being made to Damon Road that we're aware of. I'm trying to make sure that our project dovetails into. As part of that, there's pedestrian improvements that are going to be made to Damon Road, which include a crosswalk. So there was a request to make sure that we have the pedestrian connections within our site that tie into the sidewalks that are going to be created. In addition, there was a request that we create sidewalks along Industrial Drive so that we can accommodate pedestrian connections. There was one other pedestrian connection that we are actually not showing on the plan that was requested. It was specific to basically making a connection on this end of the property. But there's a couple controlling factors and some concerns from the proponent about one of them was we had eliminated a dumpster through our work back and forth with Carolyn. And initially, I basically, without permission, I had agreed to it. And the concern for the applicant is that because of the use, the restaurant use here, sharing that dumpster with another tenant or owner would be very difficult and it would potentially cause problems. We anticipate that this will likely could be an office use, could be, you know, what's allowed in this zoning district, so it wouldn't specifically be an office use, but we don't anticipate that this will be an overly intensive use, and we're not anticipating that it's going to be a restaurant at a particular location. So the idea of sharing a dumpster was something that was seen as problematic from an operational standpoint. So what we're showing is kind of a hybrid of all of the sheets. We have multiple sheets that we provided to your board and also are being provided at the same time to the planning board. We have some landscaping throughout the site that we detailed in specific on our landscaping sheets. But essentially there's entrances planned in the front and the back of each of these buildings. There's bioretention areas, surface stormwater basins, similar to a rain garden. In these two locations here. So one of the reasons that we had not provided that pedestrian connection here is there was 2 conflicts, one of them being the drive aisle, and we were trying to figure out the best way to get that done. You know, it ended up being, in our opinion, kind of disjunct and not logical, and we have leak offs because of these surface basins. We don't have subsurface catch basin structures, so we have areas where the stormwater needs to leak off directly into these stormwater basins. In order to do that, crossing it with a sidewalk would have been in conflict. We had looked at maybe doing little bridges. It ended up getting a little nutty for us in the office. So we're hoping that you understand why we don't want to do that. It's not that we didn't take that comment seriously. We do appreciate the concern over pedestrian connections. But everything else that I believe has been provided, and we've worked closely with the planning department. We do have comments from the engineering department, which I believe
Let me, if I might say, I know you're going to be going before the planning board tonight. We have limited jurisdiction through the zoning board, so what you're discussing now is probably more in the permit of the planning board, yeah.
Well, I mean, just to clarify that, yeah, I mean, I think the, in terms of the pedestrian, so the biggest issue is this is an increase in trip generation from a one non-conforming use to a new non-conforming use. So the board has to make the determination that those increases are mitigated. So pedestrian safety is important. I think that it does, even if you feel that it's met the criteria for some issues, the planning board still may require other things that you may not see on here because of their site plan criteria. So there are some, I think it's definitely in your purview to look at safety issues with these changes. But I just also wanted to let you know that the planning board may go beyond what you may or may not decide.
So I think that concludes, you know, I think it was very fairly thorough. If there's any questions you have, I'd be happy to address those.
So we're down to two curb cuts, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. I can sort of see the general, and then I saw what you were pointing to. So that one, the second one on industrial is gone.
That is correct. We originally had proposed three curb cuts. That was a concern of the planning department. We eliminated that. And this is, you know, it's going to be a little tricky to back out of here, but people will be able to do it.
Well, I see you've changed the parking to straight in as opposed to diagonal.
Yes.
Questions?
Yeah, can you talk about the decision to not develop any traffic data? To do a traffic study?
Okay, so there's, you know, in our communication with the planning department, we were basically, it's my understanding that this intersection has been studied definitely. Very specific to the improvements that were constructed out here. So we did communicate with the DPW department, engineering, and did communicate with planning staff, and we provided, I believe, a trip generation analysis to kind of talk to explain what new traffic we would expect, how many of those trips would be passed by trips, etc. So that was provided. As far as studying and looking at the redesign of the intersection, didn't make sense to us because it's already being done. And those improvements are actually, I believe, are scheduled for 2020. So we felt that, you know, the work being done was already in place. I don't know if that's consistent, but that was our understanding.
I didn't see information about traffic projections.
So I believe it was submitted in the planning board submission.
Talked about 65, 62 spaces.
Oh yeah,
it was 65.
Yeah,
parking. Yeah. I'm talking about traffic on Damon Road.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah. So just to clarify, because DOT is doing a reconstruction of industrial Damon Road, and actually it's wrapping around to the first driveway entrance of this corner parcel. So DOT is making the improvements for Damon Road all the way around, including the sidewalks all the way up to that driveway and Industrial Drive. And so there's been a whole analysis of traffic patterns. The signal was installed right there at Industrial Drive and Damon Road. So instead of doing a full-blown traffic study, which looks at traffic patterns, that's already been done by DOT. We also have pretty good data about what fast food takeout restaurants generate in terms of trips. So the applicant essentially asked for a waiver from doing the full-blown study because all the data is out there. So that's why you don't see it in your...
So can we get some idea about what the traffic generated by this type of business versus car ownership?
Yes, and I believe, do you happen to have, I believe we provide, I know we put, was a document, I believe, a memo from JSP, Land Development.
Yeah, I think I left my planning board stack upstairs, so let me just see if it's in here.
I do have that document, I believe, and I think that you bear with me for one.
I would appreciate it.
I have a memo from, thank you for bearing with me. I have a memo from JSP Land Development dated August 11th. There's a great deal of information to the letter. Let me see if I can get to the summary findings. The proposed multi-use development will include two separate structures totaling approximately 8,750 square feet of proposed floor space. The proposed uses will include retail space and restaurant services, as you're aware. Parking for the development will be provided on-site with approximately 62 spaces. Below is a summary of our findings. For planning purposes, the proposed project is estimated to generate approximately 128 vehicle turns into the project site during the typical weekday morning peak hour. Okay? And the site will be used at its busiest. During the
evening peak hours, 7 to 9.
Yes, I think it's, yes, confirm that. So during the evening peak hour, the site traffic will be about half the morning volume with an estimated 54 vehicle turns into the site. ITE data identifies that approximately 50% of the site generated traffic will be pass-by trips or traffic already traveling along Damon Road. This estimate is based on the use-specific data collected for fast food restaurants and can be argued to be conservative for morning commuter traffic when applied to coffee donut shops similar to those project. During a typical weekday morning peak hour, the project is expected to generate approximately 67 new vehicles to Damon Road. Weekday evening, Saturday peak hours are expected to experience somewhat less increases, with the site generating 35 new vehicles and 62 new vehicles respectively.
So that's per day, these last figures?
It's during a typical weekday morning peak
that's
hour.
That's still okay,
yeah,
thank you.
Yeah, so that's an hour, right?
So of 128, 67 are new.
Correct. 67 new vehicles to Damon Road. Yep. Weekday evening and Saturday peak hours are expected to experience less, with 35 new vehicles and 62 new vehicles respectively.
So just to sort of put that number in perspective, so the issue isn't about capacity on Damon Road or Industrial Drive. It's really about the turning movements that are created with those new trips. So one of the things that staff felt was important was to really constrain the turning movements, particularly on Damon Road. DOT is going to come in and spend all this money to make these improvements to Damon Road. And they've already put this signalized intersection there at Industrial Drive and Damon as part of this project, the precursor to that.
But I don't see how that necessarily can help if the turn into property is right off of Damon Road. It's not at the lights, right? Wouldn't it be?
It's better that way.
The left turn in, as you're coming down from the Route 9, yes.
There will be no left
turn. There's no left turn. Yeah.
That's the restriction.
Okay.
To clarify.
So how do you get in? You have to take the left onto Industrial and then
correct.
Come all the way around.
That's correct.
And then the only way out of there is a right turn.
Right turn.
On Damon.
Right turn onto Damon or taking a right out here and then a left.
Okay.
The idea is to really require people to use the signal because that's there to control and make it safer for left turning movements.
Know, and this may be a little bit beyond us, but do you know whether that's going to generate any changes in the signal duration in either direction? Timing, because you know we've had some significant issues with that light.
Yeah,
with this light here.
Yes. We'll tag on to that question and ask if we need to be concerned about backup to the river crossing because there's only like 5 car lengths there.
The right in, well, that's another reason to ensure that there's no left-turning movement, because if you're going west on Damon Road and you're trying to make a left, that's going to stop the traffic on the other direction. So by prohibiting that left turn of movement, it's going to allow the eastbound traffic to continue.
Assuming people follow
the right.
Yeah,
right.
Follow.
And the sidewalk will only extend for the length of the building. It won't come further west down Damon Road, right?
It's going towards
Route 9. There's nothing
on the other
that's
side.
It's not the other side of the street. There is no sidewalk proposed. My understanding is there's no sidewalk.
No, I don't mean the other side of the street. I mean, as you're heading down across the railroad tracks towards King Street, there's not going to be any continuation of any sidewalk in that direction, right?
Only on the north side of Damon.
That's in the plan to be.
So right here, you're saying over here, there's no sidewalk. So the DOT is planning the sidewalk only on the north side.
Okay.
They're not allowing any sidewalk construction on the south side because they want to control the crossings.
A lot of people cross that street right there. Mm-hmm. Every time.
That's not on our. Well, it's going to be part of the Damon Road reconstruction.
I drive by there every day. Mm-hmm. I drive by there every day. Two real problems. So people are always crossing right there on pedestrians.
At the bridge?
And there are no sidewalks either side. And also the light, if you turn in the light, I would think that if you're coming west on Damon Road and you go up to the light, that light has a turn signal on so you can cut across traffic that's on only long enough for one tractor trailer to come into the industrial park. So if you don't, there will be a lot of time for people to safely make a turn, the westbound traffic, to safely make a turn in on Damon Road. That would be no problem. But it's going to be a problem if you make it so you have to turn in at the light, because you'll end up with tractor trailer traffic being backed up all the way down that road. Because there's not enough room, time at the light for it to handle the traffic. It's two lanes traffic and the going west. And the one lane of traffic handles traffic on straight out Bridge Road, and the other lane handles traffic that's turning on at 91 to the X down to 91 and on North King Street. And it's already really iffy to get through that.
Well, timing signaling is adjustable in that signal. My guess is, and I don't know, I'm not an engineer, I'm not going to try to pretend to be one, but my guess is when they do the whole fix, the whole idea about the improvements to Damon Road is to connect the two interchanges, you know, exit 18 and exit 19. So when they do that as part of that, I'm sure they're going to look at the signal timing.
When I'm sitting right there waiting for the truck to come around the corner, I've got all the time in the world. Well, then there are no traffic coming the other way.
That's if you're heading east. Well, but the engineers, I mean, that may be anecdotal information that you have, but the reality is a left turn is the cause for more accidents than anything else. It's the conflict of turns that create the accidents. So you may see something in one snapshot of your day when you're there, but it's really important for city engineers, and they've stated that you know, the left turns into here have to be constrained, because the whole reason for that intersection is to create a safe left turn onto Industrial Road.
Yeah, it's just going to create a snake.
Am I correct in understanding that the drawings are currently at about 35% for that improvement?
I think they're more than
farther
that.
Along.
Yeah.
Okay.
If I can just make one comment, because I've been involved there, where Rob and I live in Westfield, there's a Dunkin' Donuts there, and I was involved, and Rob was involved with the Westfield Bank,
redevelopment of a former gas station as a Home Depot. It's a very, very highly trafficked area with a lot of turn movements. And the signalization was a big issue. We went through this whole thing with the bank and with Dunkin' Donuts and the Home Depot. And since they've developed that whole area, it's working pretty well now, and it's a huge volume area. They've changed the timing on the lights. That's my only comment is, I've noticed that they tweak it when they have these issues of queuing and backing up, so that when you're like coming out of the Home Depot trying to cut across Route 20, you've got about 10 seconds. I mean, they've actually watched the number of cars that are queuing up, and they change it. And conversely, on the other side of the street, when they're trying to bleed the traffic onto Route 20, the signals are longer. So the DOT does come out, especially in a redevelopment, and they do observe any of the queuing problems and stacking problems, and they do adjust those lights all the time until they get it right. I've seen it firsthand, and I've been involved in a few projects. So it's not our control of how the lights will be changed, but I guarantee you, when they first open it, and a year later or 2 years later, they're going to be tweaking those signalizations.
Well, they're going to have to, because the turn left onto Industrial from Damon, if you're heading west, you know, that lane also accommodates cars that are continuing straight, and it gets them into the correct lane to turn left at King Street and to go straight onto Bridge. And there are a lot of people who avail themselves of that lane and aren't turning left. So
that's going to be a work in process.
I lived in LA, so I don't really complain about our traffic, but you can complain about our traffic when Damon Road backs up to Route 9, you know, at certain hours of the day. So we don't have control over the traffic, right? I mean, isn't that more of a planning board issue? So I think
this is just a question of theoretical
and, you know, a concern, but I think we need to sort of concentrate on, you know, the pedestrian safety, the curb cuts, the increased traffic, and see if there are any concerns that we have or conditions that we might want to impose.
But increasing driver safety is also
absolutely an issue,
not just the pedestrian.
Carol, could you give us a little more background on what the plans for Damon Road are, what the hope is?
So they're at 75% design phase now, so they're getting close to being completed. The idea is really to add, I mean, there'll be bike lanes added, there'll be sidewalks added from, you know, King Street to Bridge Street.
So they're going to widen the road to do that?
There's enough right-of-way. They'll widen the area used. So the right-of-way goes beyond the paved way right now.
So are they losing some right-of-way for this?
My understanding is that the edge of pavement will shift within the right-of-way. So they're not expanding the right-of-way, but the edge of pavement will shift at least a few feet to the south.
Right, in this area and along the entire stretch. There's an area within what the DOT layout is that they can make for sidewalk and bike path.
It's within the right-of-way.
And this is an alternative. They're making these improvements. Damon Road is congested because of the exit interchange problems. 18 and 19 are not full interchanges. So they need to make these improvements as one of the pieces of the puzzle to facilitate those two interchanges. And this is the connector between the two, and obviously the connector between University and Northampton's, or the bypass, if you will. So that's the reason for the Damon Road changes, but we're also including other facilities on the network, because we have River Run residential condominiums there. There are commercial businesses on Damon Road. People need to access those other than by cars. So
the plan is to introduce bicycle lanes and sidewalk the entire way on one side of the street from King to the bridge?
Yeah, to Bridge Street, yeah.
Is there any plan to change? This may be a little bit of field, but if there is that significant increase in traffic because of this, and then there's more use of the other businesses along Damon, people can still take a left coming out of those. Is there any plan to deal with that? If there are more people,
Especially as those projects redevelop, the city definitely is looking at that. I haven't looked at the design plans now to see what they are, you know, if DOT is actually going to go down and make modifications to the number of curb cuts or the width of curb cuts as part of the construction. I mean, they've done that in other places, like on Pond Street.
If I could, I think it's important to note that early on in our design process, we actually requested those plans from DPW engineering. They provided them to our office. We've worked with DPW and engineering and have provided our drawings for review. So they have the MassDOT's, I guess it's 75% plans. They have reviewed our plans against those plans, and there's been coordination, even discussion of curbing materials at the entrances, that specific. So I'm not aware, in the memo that was provided from the engineering department, I'm not aware of any traffic concerns that they've expressed. I believe that they were, I don't want to say they signed off on it, I don't know what the correct term is, but no concerns.
Yeah. No red flags in terms of the use of the property.
What would be the hours of operation?
Hours of operation?
5 to midnight.
5
to 11.
Sorry, to 11?
5 to 11, 5 to midnight.
In the morning, the traffic's backed up to the O'Hood and Funeral Home on Bridge Street. And, 62 more cars. That doesn't mean anything. I mean, it's just a big traffic jam all the way down to to where you try to go across the bridge.
The Jetsons.
Coolidge Bridge. And the only place to get coffee is the Dunkin' Donuts in Haydenville. So you pass Dunkin' Donuts in Haydenville, and you go down there and get your coffee before you get to Amherst.
Oh, no, there's Dunkin' Donuts at the Pride Station.
This would be a replacement.
Other questions for Mr. Think about it and maybe we can call you. But I just wanted to see if I know. Thank you.
Thank you.
Is there anybody else that is here to speak in favor of this proposal? All right, then. Moving right along. Are there folks here to speak against the proposal?
I make a motion to oppose.
All right. Do you want to take a crack at that? Well, so what they're proposing is office and office is allowed in the industrial district and a small component of retail. So you would approve the configuration of, and retail is not typically allowed in the industrial district, but as presented, they could do, if you approve the finding, they would be able to fill out that space with the amount of retail shown versus the office shown. They could expand the office to the entire building because that's allowed anyway. So the only reason why it would come back would be if they expanded the footprint of the restaurant or if they want to convert the office component or frankly the retail component to another use that wasn't allowed in the industrial district.
And then I did recommend as well, they're proposing, the application indicates that they're going to extend the sidewalk farther beyond the property in the right-of-way south. But there wasn't much discussion about that, but the reason for that is that the zoning requires applicants to provide sidewalks along all frontages of property, but in this case, DOT has a specific design criteria for sidewalks, and they're building a sidewalk for a portion of the lot. So the discussion we've had with the applicant was to take the amount of frontage sidewalk that they would have otherwise been required to do along Damon Road, and the segment that's already being created for them by DOT, and extend that south. So in the right-of-way, on Industrial Drive, but that would expand the access, pedestrian access, for other users, either Industrial Drive or even farther south is the neighborhood, you know, the North Street neighborhood. So that creates an element of safety. My only other condition, possible condition for you to consider would be just to make sure that that is completed. You know, typically when a site plan is proposed, the applicant has to complete all the improvements on the site before a certificate of occupancy. It's not clear to applicants that that's the trigger requirement. So that's an option. I'm not, you know, if they're, you approve what's presented, they have to build it as they presented it. So I'm not really wedded to you adopting that condition.
So this crosswalk, what happens between when they build it? How does the timing work? They can't put a crosswalk to a sidewalk that doesn't exist.
They are not going to install the crosswalk across Industrial Drive. That's a DOT crosswalk.
Okay, so they allowed to build a ramp that
would do the sidewalk. They would build the sidewalk to the ramp, right. Yeah. DOT is going to be building the ramp, so they'll build the sidewalk up to that point. Based on the designs that we have, because we already have the designs of where that's going to end.
And crosswalk signs?
That's all part of the signal. DOT
so is paying for that. So it will be a signal crosswalk.
Yes, because they're going to install that, and that's when they'll activate the signal. So it's already built into the signal mechanism to have a pedestrian crossing. But there's no safe way to do that. There's no sidewalk, so they haven't activated the signal.
So, the question of concern I have is entrance and exit. Just this in theory, and you're just describing how we're directing people to go and coming from every direction, is based on people following the law. And as Bob pointed out, if people are waiting behind a trailer truck and they see nobody coming, they're going to do a left-hand turn. Feel like, and the right-hand turn, unless it's a really severe ramp that forces somebody to not cut back, we're setting up something that is really dependent on drivers following the law.
Well, can I check that plan, because that was a discussion that we've had back and forth with the applicant, yeah, that they really have to make a hard...
It's not as strong as I would like to see. Yeah. It's very, it's better than the other plan.
I think you're right on that front, and I think that is a big concern for the city, that it really has to force you to turn right and not turn left into the site. So you can certainly condition the permit to say, you know, this is, you're adding new turns and new, you know, auto dealerships aren't busy 7 to 9 in the morning and not, you know, and they can be busy on PM peak, but it's not like a takeout coffee shop. So this becomes much more of an important issue at this intersection. And it's perfect, so that change from, you know, one non-conforming use to another non-conforming use, it's going to generate more trips and turning movements, means that you all certainly have the jurisdiction to condition it to make this a more significant, you know.
All this stuff is really relative. Well, I used to go into that Dodge dealership and never had a problem. The other day I was at the Dodge dealership on King Street and you take your life plan. So it's a matter of what you want to buy in a coffee for your conference.
You know, the alternative is, you know, we only allow one curb cut per parcel, typically, unless you get a permit from the planning board. So two curb cuts by itself without a permit is something that generates a requirement for a permit from the planning board. So it's sort of, it's, and so you could argue that only one access point is appropriate because of this location on Damon Road. The alternative to that is, okay, if you want two access points, you have to make it a really hard, forced, right in, right out. So we definitely, at the staff level, feel that we know that especially corner parcels like to have more than one access point, and that makes sense, I think, to the extent, though, that you make sure that you're forcing that right in, right out only. So if you feel like it's appropriate to put a condition to say that, you know, maybe it has to be a granite curb that forces you right and left, that has a 6-inch reveal or whatever, that, you know, that's within your purview.
As would be entry only on Industrial Drive, entry exit, and only right-way exit, and no entry on Damon. Is that a possibility?
They have that on King Street at the Stop and Shop and Liquors 44.
Oh, that's right.
So they have that, and I have stopped for people coming in off King Street and that turn across traffic. And I've been in a car when a well-known city official made that turn.
We still need a motion
to have this conversation, but I would just say that I don't think it makes sense to limit the entrance and exit just to the one. I think it makes sense to have some conditions on the turning. But if you limit it to this one on Industrial Drive, you're just going to back up traffic all the way to Damon Road. And then it's going to back up on Industrial, and it's going to create a problem. I think the freer flowing traffic with the conditions makes more sense.
And the concern about people planning to go from Bridge Street, going in, entering here, where they're not supposed to, the likelihood.
For Bridge Street to go in on Damon
Bridge Street.
This way, coming
from here. They're not allowed to turn left here. But my concern is if it's backed up and the light is red and I see an opening, you're going to turn left there.
Yeah, and they can turn left into the exit rather than the entrance. So you also have to turn left.
No, Bridge Street. Sorry.
I'm sorry. The Coolidge Bridge.
Yeah, got it. Coolidge Bridge. Okay. Confusing it with Bridge Road. Sorry. So say that again.
People coming from
Bridge.
Yep. And they want to go to Dunkin' Donuts, mm-hmm. like we all do. And they know they've got to enter here. Uh-huh. The light's red, or traffic's backed up. They see a clean break, and they come.
Yes, but if I think, as Carolyn is suggesting, we can require this to make that left turn impossible. We can make that an easy right turn, but an impossible left turn by creating a barrier this.
Yeah.
No, I think that we're trying to decide whether this is a significantly more detrimental to the community. Right. And we don't need to be the ones who decide that, because they're going to go through all this with the planning board. So we have to just decide if this is significantly more detrimental, this change of of non-metering use from auto sales to...
That is our standard. I think we do have the authority to add conditions, and this could be one, the planning board may override us.
But we're not going anywhere with this condition that we're trying to figure out.
If the level of potential increase in it being detrimental, but safety level could be satisfied by setting some conditions, then that's within our...
To me, the more you are setting these conditions, the more hazardous it becomes. Because the way it is right now, it's fine. It would be better if people were allowed to turn off Damon Road, westbound traffic on Damon Road, Damon Road were allowed to turn into the project. That would be, from my point of view, safer. And to make it so that only eastbound traffic can turn in and westbound traffic has to go up to the light, that traffic gets in the way of people like me who are going west on Bridge Road, onto Bridge Road. I get in that lane.
Wouldn't you similarly hold up traffic if you were turning left, heading west on Damon? If you were turning left, all the people behind you would have to live for you to take that left?
If you're like me and you're heading toward Haydenville, Weeds, that area, you're in, or Thorns, you're in that truck turning lane so that you can go straight across at the on the Bridge Street, and there are trucks ahead of you. One truck has time to get across that road. One truck has time to turn there. And if you can't turn in this with no traffic coming and the light in your favor, when is it going to be safer?
So you want to try this motion and
I'll try
see.
The motion
okay.
without any conditions
okay.
about the planning board
and the
engineers sort of
see where that goes.
Yeah.
We'll try
yeah. I'll make a motion that we approve the project that the finding for a project of 55 Damon Road, commercial finding for a change from non-conforming auto sales use to a non-conforming takeout restaurant and conforming office use without conditions.
Is there a second?
I'll second the motion.
I have a question for Carolyn. Mm-hmm. Two questions. One is, does the planning board in fact deal with this issue?
They will also review that.
Okay.
They will review it. It's also within your purview to think about that as well.
Okay. And the other question is, do we have any concerns about, three questions, about the reduction or the unmet need on the number of parking spaces? It doesn't seem to be significant. It's just a few, but...
Yeah, so that's actually, there's also a site plan approval process for planning board to look at that.
Okay, so we don't have to worry about
it. It would be my recommendation that it's my recommendation to the planning board that they approve it.
So we don't have to worry about it. And then what about lighting? I mean, that's all controlled and
that's
standardized
all
anyway, so
right.
We don't need to worry about that.
Right.
Okay. All right. So is there more discussion on the motion? The motion is for approval without conditions.
No, I'm not convinced yet.
And to pass this, it needs to be two out of three of us.
Right. And you can make a friendly amendment, you could propose, take a vote and then make another motion.
What I would say to this motion is that I'm going to vote in favor of it because I'm going to assume that the planning board will deal with this, number one, but the more overriding rationale for me is that I think it's a major improvement in an area that's been, sitting there unused, and I think I have some serious concerns about the amount of traffic. This is a horrible intersection of all intersections in the city. I ride my bike, and the underpass cut through is not yet available. And I have once on the
part, or twice we've been parts of Damon Road, and it is taking the life of my hand. So I'm really concerned about the amount of traffic, but I think overall, with the reduction in the curb cuts and the use of the space into something that's beneficial to the city, I think I'm going to be supportive.
I agree with so many of those things, but I'm very uncomfortable with saying that as is, safety based on the traffic in relation to that intersection is not an issue. And leaving it to the planning board doesn't feel responsible to me. I know it's one of the many things they're going to have.
I hear you, and I'm not, I said they're wrong, and it's not just total subordination to the planning board as much as I do understand Bob's rationale, and it has a blessing, whatever. It's endlessly frustrating for me when I can take a left turn, not being able to, and then having to face that light and having to go all the way around. And so I think we've seen an increase in this city of control. Most recently, those speed bumps on Naugatuck, which are problematic, and the more lights, like the lighted industrial, I mean, that has a purpose. Implementation was a little slow in terms of efficiency, but so I tend to err on the side of hoping or assuming that people are able to work with the situation in a way that makes sense. I know that's not always the case. I know that the exit onto Pleasant Street from, what's that, behind of Louis, you know, it's a left turn,
yeah,
and people
right.
are always right. taking that left turn. So I know it's not complete, but I do err on the side of less rather than more. And I'm okay with being overridden on that by others, but I'm not sure that I want to be overridden. So, I appreciate it.
Well, I would be more comfortable with the condition that they be directed by the way the curb, by the way those that entrance exit is designed to, and I don't consider that control. I consider it. I get your point. I live on Naugatuck Street, but the you're entering a very busy intersection. You're coming up to a set of lights where there's tractor trailers, and you're already visually navigating a lot of things and trying to figure out where your lane changes in relation to that. I think anything that assists people in saying this is what I should do, this is what I can't do, would be helpful to drivers. And I feel much more comfortable.
Yeah.
You know, maybe the planning commission will come up with this planning board, but I feel very uncomfortable introducing that kind of two-way exit entrance that close to that intersection.
The use of this being changed from an auto dealership to a drive-through restaurant is not significant in our detriment. That's what our issue is. It's not,
well,
we don't have any say about that, because if we put a condition in there, then we're constraining people who are going to go through every bit of this paper and come up with the conditions. And I haven't gone through this. I'm not gonna, it's not my job. And so this is not significantly more detrimental.
What I'm saying is I see the nature of this business quite different than the nature of a car dealership, because of the behavior of traffic, of entrance and exits at certain key times of day. So that's where I see a difference in, I do feel the type of business is quite different. Not just that it's a restaurant
different.
Or a takeout.
It's different, but it's not significantly more detrimental. If we start quibbling about the difference between a difference and significantly more detrimental than the...
I don't think it's quibbling. I mean, I think you're right about the standard, but we do have the authority to impose some conditions, so...
We do have the right to...
And I get Bob's point. I get your point. But these conditions are on some side, like ancillary to, is there a significant difference? Is this type of business significantly detrimental or more detrimental than the other non-existing?
I think, unless there's more discussion, I think we're ready for the vote.
I'm ready to vote.
Okay. All those in favor?
I support it.
Thanks.
Good on speed.
Good luck.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, good luck. We have minutes.
Yes.
You want this set of plans?
That's the old one.
Yeah.
Oh, this is the old one?
Yeah.
Oh, you cycled it?
I can take that.
Okay.
So I think the only other thing was for the minutes.
Yes.
These are the minutes from August 24th, 2017. Do I have a motion to accept?
All right, I motion to accept.